comes up in the summer as well. But right now, Epiphany, this church season, is an appropriate and fitting time. It's been a season where we've been celebrating divine revelations that practically dare us to miss the mystery of God made known to humanity in Jesus. Jesus invites us to see ourselves and reality differently because of God's being with us in the flesh. Love incarnate lights up the world, changing us with its power. And that obvious power was palpable up there on the mountain as Peter, James, and John glimpsed Jesus in a new light. There, love's threefold invitation comes to them, and we perceive its call to us in our unknowing too. Because when Jesus draws near, all reality is illuminated with the light of love. You might have noticed that this Wednesday we start into a new church season. Lent starts with Ash Wednesday, and it's a time where, as a community, we'll be invited to experiment with some practices of love in action. Now, today, though, before we kick into gear with that, I think we have an opportunity to explore this gospel and see in it some prerequisites for loving action. Right there, with Jesus and his disciples on the mountaintop. Peter is the one whose experience first clues us in. He is the one to whom that first loving imperative comes. Stop. No, it wasn't actually there in the text. You didn't miss anything. Jesus doesn't say it specifically, nor does anyone else. But the bright cloud that overshadows the disciples kicks in, eclipses everything, just as Peter wants to run off and do something special for Jesus. Yes, he's understandably excited by what's unfolding around them. Elijah and Moses are not their contemporaries. And yet, they're right there with Jesus in this sacred summit. I don't think I have the guts to say, hey, I have an idea. Let's ask the dead guys to stay and hang out with us. You gotta give it to Peter. He recognizes the luminaries and he knows how to roll up the red carpet for these honored guests. Peter doesn't want the revelation to end. The energy is so electrifying. But his words also telegraph something, especially his choice of pronouns. If you wish, Lord, I will make three dwellings for you, Elijah and Moses. Not James and John and me. I will do it. It's understandable that this holy power that's percolating all around is something he feels revved up by and wants to lean into. But every time this little human tendency to sort of put ourselves at the center or to grasp and to cling and to want to be in the middle of it all, it's something God invites to bring into the light. And stopping is one way that love invites us to surrender, have our habits reshaped. Yes, I think like Peter, we all have that ego part of ourselves that wants to be right there in the middle, in the mix, and it's naturally in a process of being reoriented, right-sized, as we encounter the divine gaze of love. Peter, to his credit, pauses in that moment, and we too can practice this loving imperative to stop. In the space between our thinking and our doing, where divine grace is always available to us, we can notice, oh, there I am, into our relationships, where one of them turns to you and says, what did I just say? Anybody have that happen before? Even when we have honed those skills of knowing how to answer on cue, reflecting back exactly those words that have been spoken to us, there are still deeper meanings for which we learn to listen. Love asks us to take the reality of what we're encountering in those people we love, to take it to heart, not just listening to what we hear, but acting in accordance with what those words have revealed. In Jesus' own tradition, there's this important prayer. It's the Shema. Its words begin, "Hear, O Israel," one of the central and oldest prayers in Judaism. It makes a fundamental claim of faith, asserting that we are in this real relationship with the one true God, the God who speaks to us, who trusts us to obey the love that flows with this connection, the one. In the language of biblical Hebrew, these two things are linked. One hears in order to act, to obey. And when we hear God's commandments in the Bible, it is always inviting us to listen and hear so that we will do, and sometimes do differently than we might otherwise be inclined. We incline our ear to God's voice so that we can obey what love commands. Love, after all, is the bedrock of God's life, God's ways. Hearing and doing the will of love is the whole point of listening. The Apostle Paul speaks about this in a more excellent way, as one that isn't just powerful in how it reshapes us, it's also powerful in what it brings into our lives and our experience. There are benefits and graces. As creatures, we need that kind of positive reinforcement. And God wants us. God made us to enjoy this feedback loop, where love's grace gives us the encouragement and the power to keep turning toward what God desires. Love blesses Peter, James, and John with awe, wonder, and peace on that mountain, the brightness of Jesus' love eclipsing their disorientation and fear. He doesn't just tell them, get up and shake it off and get on with it. Jesus is drawn near to them with reassuring care. He was fully connected to the life of love that is God's own life, and Jesus was enlivened with the power to receive it and to share it. He channels that love to Peter, James, and John, who are there huddled in fear on the ground. They're so confused. Jesus touches them physically as he speaks those clarifying words of comfort. Now, I realize we don't get the benefit of what they have experienced up there. Last time I checked, Jesus isn't coming around and giving me a hug when I'm afraid. But there are ways in which we learn to tune in to that love that is present. inviting God's presence to fill us with hope, to encourage us on the way, and to look forward into the next day. It's really simple. It's like 5 steps. It doesn't take long at all, and I find that it's pretty helpful in my life. If you've ever done any kind of meditation that says, think back what you did across the day, feel what you felt in your body. I know a lot of people have been using that to relax and handle stress. If you've done it ever, you can do this form of praying. Maybe you have a different practice that you like because it helps you listen. I'd love to hear about it. I think as we share with each other what works or doesn't, what questions are coming up for us, we help grow our capacity to listen. The hardest part of prayer for me, just like any form of listening, is the waiting. Wondering what to do when I don't hear a thing. Worrying about whether I'm jumping ahead, thinking about what I'm going to say in response. Maybe growing weary with the boredom that can be part of the waiting. Waiting is actually the third loving imperative that I notice in this story of Jesus' transfiguration. Because love sometimes asks us to wait. This word isn't explicit in this story, but it is implied by what Jesus says at the end when he says to his friends, don't talk about what's just happened. Wait. Wait until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead. Mum's the word. It might seem a little bit weird, since these men were always with Jesus. They saw all the amazing things that the love in his ministry was accomplishing as they traveled together, teaching and healing and encountering the crowds of people who wanted to come close to Jesus and feel his love. Waiting is a practice that teaches us humility. Much of our spiritual lives are lived in spaces of unknowing, times where we understand only in some limited way. Experiences with God on the spiritual journey take time to process. And waiting without words teaches us to trust God's presence and God's timing. Waiting increases our capacity to listen amid the noise and busyness of our lives so that the voice of love can really invite us to be fully alive, human beings more than human doings. This waiting helps us trust that the Creator, the Son, and the Spirit, this trinity of loving relationship, is what we're caught up in, connected with, energized by, as love transforms our world. Stop. Listen. Wait. Last weekend, a guided hike in San Mateo County gave me a personal pathway to explore this invitation to stop, listen, and wait. The trail that morning glistened with new rain. Newts, banana slugs, and blazing orange mushrooms stopped me in my tracks with awe and wonder. There were stories as people talked together, humming all around. Sights and sounds of God's life, full of beauty and grace. I don't know what all that glory means just yet, but I know that Jesus was near. At the beginning of the sermon, I said, Jesus invites us to see ourselves and reality differently because of God's being with us in the flesh. I believe this with all my heart. Jesus' invitation calls out to us in love.